Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Swallowed by the Great Land and Other Dispatches from Alaska's Frontier by Seth Kantner. Narrated by Gabriel Vaughan. Introduction. Here in the Northwest Arctic, over the years, I've noticed that Inupiaq friends and acquaintances, when introducing themselves, have a way of starting with where they were born, their parents' names, and how they grew up. Without even noticing, I guess I absorbed that cultural way of considering myself. For me, now 50 years old, everything begins on a 2-mile-long bluff called Punaktoruk, where I was born and raised in a sod igloo along the Kobuk River. My parents, Howard and Erna Kantner, were not miners or teachers or homesteaders. They were just people who admired the old Inupiaq way of life. In that life, my brother and I were taught to skin animals, run dog teams, and do subsistence activities. Caribou and wolves, bears and wolverines, and other animals were significantly more common than humans. My family didn't wake up mornings and disappear to daily jobs and school. Mostly, we all stayed home on the hill, cutting wood, scraping hides, drying fish, and hunting, which often meant waiting for food and furs to come to us. The nearest village, Ambler, was 25 miles away. Visitors, hunters, and travelers didn't show for weeks on end, sometimes longer, and were a welcome sight on the land. Nearly everyone we knew in Ambler and other villages hunted and fished, picked berries, and hauled firewood. Depending on the season, people were busy gathering various necessities from the country. Outsiders, who over the years appeared from the south, commonly referred to as white people, even if they happened to be black, Asian, or otherwise, would shake hands and, before long, invariably ask, "What do you do?" None of us were quite sure how to answer that strange question. In the villages and out on the tundra and along the river, most people didn't have careers. It made no sense why these outsiders all carried that question north. "We just live," is what folks replied, and shrugged and glanced at the sky to check the weather, and at the river to check if any animals were crossing. We just live. Just living is what these stories are about. Life here, and some of the characters living it, above the Arctic Circle, and hundreds of miles from the nearest road. Locally, a seasonal nomadic lifestyle has always made sense. Villagers often boated to the coast in summer to escape mosquitoes and to fish. In winter, people roamed far and wide, trapping. In fall and spring, hunters from the coast traveled upriver and inland to find caribou and waterfowl. Around the time I turned 9, my family started fishing for salmon in Kotzebue Sound. It meant a 150-mile boat trip down the Kobuk and across the bay to camp at Nuvaruk, near other fishermen from villages around the region. It was there we first met Bob and Carrie Yule, wise elders and friends who appear and reappear in my writings. I've continued to commercial fish 40 years and more now. When I turned 30 and was married, my wife got a real job in Kotzebue. At that point, I hired on with the garden project, doing seasonal work assisting gardeners along the Kobuk and up the coast to Kivalina and down to Deering. Winters, I roam the hills and sea ice surrounding Kotzebue and travel upriver to our old igloo, always gathering, although now my harvest includes photographs and stories in addition to meat and berries, furs, and firewood. I spend spring and fall at home on that bluff called Punaktoruk. There, my wife and daughter, Stacy and China, often accompany me. Other times, I am alone, though our dog, Worf, sometimes came with me before he passed on. My ties to the land remain of utmost importance to my identity, as is the case for many people in this region. Over the years, my family's strongest ties to the village have been via the Williams family, Don and Mary, who repeatedly turn up in my stories. They have been a second family to me and mine, as have their kids, Alvin, Cindy, and Jennifer. Andrew Green later married Jennifer and became my fishing partner and close friend. He appears and reappears in these stories, too. No account of local characters along this river and out on the tundra, in my stretch of years, could be complete without one name, Clarence Wood. Here, where hunters vie for status, he towers above the rest. Growing up on that windblown bluff, when my brother and I heard our dogs barking the warning that meant visitors, or heard the distant drone of a snowmobile, our first guess was Clarence. He spent countless nights at our small home, paid countless visits, drank countless cups of coffee sitting on our bearskin couch. His humor, his knowledge of the wild, his way of telling tales, his legendary toughness out on the land, all beg for many more words than I've put down here. This collection of words, these dispatches from the Arctic, span 6 or 7 years and are mostly in chronological order, but sometimes move back and forth in time. I was raised in a life of making things to survive, not buying material goods, and have always made my kayaks, wood stoves, boats, sleds, and the like. To this day, I feel the need to create. Writing, for me, creates a way to unravel the dichotomies between the candle-lit memories of our first sod igloo and the glowing screen of today. Writing is my way to possibly illuminate a trail or two through the blizzard of change that has swept north. I hope these stories shine a light on this amazing place, the people and animals and land of my home, the Arctic. Part 1. Life Around the Igloo. Memories of a Handmade Man. Snowflakes were falling, coming down on already deep drifts outside our windows. Winter and a gray world out there stretching to dark horizons. I don't recall how Oliver Cameron arrived at the buried sod igloo where I grew up, but I picture him coming on snowshoes, plodding, dragging one of his home-fashioned narrow runner sleds, the line of runner tracks already buried by the time he pulled his parka off beside our stove. Snowshoe travel makes sense, certainly, and it was handmade snowshoes that he spent weeks that winter building for my mom and brother in our small house during his visit. For the first few days, he filed at my dad's rickshaw with a triangle file. He worked each metal tooth until he was satisfied with how he'd modified it, making it bigger and sharper and adjusting the set to the teeth. Oliver always enjoyed filing and whittling tools and handles down until he liked them better than before. He was a tall, thin man who wore heavy drab patched clothes, wool pants and a wool shirt, always buttoned at the sleeves. He had broad, square shoulders. His wrists and throat were pale, his fingers long and rough from making everything by hand. He had big ears and broad lips, and if you paid attention, you noticed his hands shook a little, something we hadn't seen during past visits. The look in his eyes and the little cap he wore, too, recalled photographs from the 1930s of thin, hungry men who lived through the Great Depression. Of course, we didn't know much of that back then. To my brother, Cole, and me, Oliver was an encyclopedia of intriguing projects. We were aware, too, of his stature along the river in the extended family of our parents and their friends. He was the man, more often than not, those back-to-the-landers turned to for expertise. He was perpetually helpful, mysterious, and strange, always serious, polite, and impossibly ancient, nearly 50 years old. After the ripsaw was fashioned to his satisfaction, he set up sawhorses across the floor of our little home. Slowly and meticulously, he sawed strips of birch wood. He wasn't in a hurry. The snow was deep, all of us deep in winter. No one we knew was in a hurry. Time and tundra we had in unlimited supply. Oliver sighted down each strip of birch, then leaned it in the corner against the post there and began ripping another. When he was done sawing all the strips he needed, he worked them down with a spokeshave and hand plane. He showed us how to hold the plane at an angle to make it cut easier. He seemed to like making things smaller and smoother. I don't remember the pale sawdust and plane shavings quite as sharply as something else in our possession back then, a store-bought item, and therefore significantly more interesting to us kids raised on the tundra than anything made from materials as natural as a birch tree and caribou leather. The item was a bag of Nestle chocolate chips, still unopened, brilliant yellow, smooth, small, and solid. You could feel the chocolate chips inside when you held the bag. It was only 16 ounces, I think, or maybe 20. On the back, printed in tiny, perfect chocolate-colored writing, was a recipe. Cole and I asked my mom if we might be allowed to bake those cookies it described. We weren't sure it would be okay, with Oliver staying the month. Mom had told us that Oliver had a problem with sweets. He couldn't resist them, but had health problems somehow connected to sugar. But chocolate chip cookies were so alluring. And there was something even more, something about that recipe. It claimed to make 80 cookies. Was that even possible? Cole and I were determined to find out. My family had a plywood table at that time. It was 2 feet wide and 5 feet long, with the corners cut off. The grain ran crossways, the narrow way, and you weren't supposed to lean on the ends. They overhung the leg framework and were unsupported, and downward pressure would crack them. We didn't have any more plywood, and it seemed very important that our table didn't break. We warned visitors and strangers about this danger promptly when they sat down. Careful, don't lean on that part. We asked Oliver if it would be okay to make cookies. He nodded and smiled politely, more comfortable with the idea than we had expected. Still, we were a little worried about what might happen. That evening, my mom cleared the table and wiped it clean with a dish rag. As we pulled each tray of hot cookies out of the cook stove, my brother and I spread them in rows on the table. The air hung thick with their warm, chocolatey smell. We didn't eat a single one. We waited for the last tray. We wanted to count them all. It seemed important to try to make 80, as the bag promised. My brother and I always had a need to verify numbers and facts, to prove or disprove claims the big world out there had the habit of sending our way. In the end, there were only 48, and we wondered how we might have made each one smaller. Oliver put down the red-handled spokeshave. He sat on a sawhorse with one leg crossed over the other, hunched forward, his wrists crossed on his thigh, thoughtfully contemplating the rows of cookies. He wasn't fiddling with birch boards now, nor filing tools into more agreeable tools. All he was doing was looking over all those cookies. I remember watching him, a little meanly, I think. Really, what we'd done was no different than baiting a trap, and suddenly feeling bad. I don't remember what Oliver's sugar problems were, just my feeling that we probably should have waited until he left to bake those cookies. But people often stayed for weeks back then, with no end to the visit in sight. And that yellow bag of chocolate was magic waiting to be unwrapped. At the same time, though, there were no other adults like Oliver, and we wanted him to stay as long as possible. Back then, kids out in cabins and igloos, far away from neighbors and other children, counted on people like Oliver to show them amazing things like how to temper steel and to clamp interesting things in the vise to carve and file out of chunks of root and bits of metal. And I guess men like Oliver, who lived hard, coarse wilderness lives, counted on families for comforts such as warm cookies. I don't remember whether he was sick and low for a few days, the way he sometimes got. I know he ate the chocolate chip cookies and eventually steamed and bent the strips of birch and formed 2 pairs of snowshoes, one for my mom and a smaller pair for my brother. I got my brother's old pair. Oliver soaked caribou hides in the corner in a wash tub to slip the hair and made a tiny knife to cut the skin into perfect thin strips of babiche, which he then wet until soft and rubbery to lace the snowshoes tight. Afterward, he let the babiche dry, and in drying, it drew up even tighter. Now, 40 years later, I still have the larger pair. I've hunted miles and miles on them. Now I wish I'd paid attention to how he did all of it, eyeing the grain of the wood and making the babiche, and that intricate pattern of lacing. But of course, I was only 6 or 7, and enamored, too, by things like that printed promise of an inconceivable quantity of cookies. Two very different childhood events. I do remember during that month, Oliver showed Cole and me how to make crooked knives for carving wooden spoons out of spruce roots, and how to anneal used files in the stove to soften the metal and then file it into sheath knives. And then how to quench the steel, and how to boil chunks of caribou antler in a pot of water until they were soft enough to pound onto the tangs of our knives for handles. And finally, to soak ugruk, bearded seal hide, to form it into sheaths for our knives. It was a bold and worldly feeling to climb into your pants in the morning and walk around as a 6-year-old with a knife on your belt, one that you'd made yourself just yesterday, with Oliver, of course. Oliver might have stayed until spring, or possibly it was another spring when he camped up by a muktuk slough along the bluff up in the big spruce trees. He walked to our house almost every day the spring he camped there. He was our only company and worked with my dad, showing him how to build a kayak, then skin it with canvas and paint the canvas with something reddish to keep it from leaking. When the ice went out, he went back upriver, in a second kayak, I think, that he built at his tent, maybe from his tent. A few evenings ago, I walked up a muktuk. I was hungry, needing meat, searching for a porcupine or spruce hen to put in the Dutch oven. Oliver's old spruce poles still lean up against a big tree in those woods. If they didn't, I probably couldn't find his camping spot all these years later. The brush is thick and lush now, growing so tall with our new warmer seasons, and so many years have carried my mind to so many places, I can't instantly remember which tree towers over his old campsite. Only those leaning poles tell me the spot. Across the river, too, along a cranberry ridge, are the gray timbers of another one of Oliver's spring camps, from later years, my teenage years. The moss and cranberry plants grow happily up the sides of abandoned poles, planed boards, and sections of firewood. Upriver, I know, are igloos he built and helped build, and lives he touched, kids and adults from Kobuk to the coast who remember him. Now I know Oliver really did live through the Great Depression and World War II, where he was a radio man in a B-24 before we ever knew him. As with memories that are so far back and so strange they feel no longer your own, it seems almost inconceivable that the kind, gentle man we followed faithfully to the workbench had been a soldier in that war. Like the heroes we read about in books, Oliver was shot down over Yugoslavia, crash-landed and survived, half-starved and hidden by partisans, and walked nearly 400 miles behind enemy lines to escape. Later, he married and moved to Kotzebue, and then to the north shore of Kobuk Lake. From there, he moved up the Kobuk River to Shugnak in 1958, and later to Ambler, where he built his own sod igloo east of the village. As is often the case with little kids, my brother and I didn't know this man's history. We didn't know where his family had gone, only that the knives and tools and snowshoes, and that kayak too, were enchanted creations fashioned from wood and skin and cloth and rusty metal, boring things brought to life. One spring evening after the ice had gone, Oliver showed us something new. To me, it will always be the epitome of his teachings. For weeks, he had told us we had to wait until breakup, when the snow melts and the river ice cracks, rises, and flows downstream, and the ground was exposed and sap was running under the bark enough for him to show us. He fashioned a short section of willow into a stubby, flute-like whistle, scored the bark in a circle, tapped it all around with his knife handle, and then, with his ears sticking out, wrapped his broad lips around the willow to wet it and further loosen the bark. Spittle, he explained. It was a new word for us, and of course it rhymed with Oliver's other favorite word, whittle. The way he did it was a little unnerving, and I remember paying attention but looking away too from that glistening saliva. Regardless, the willow whistles he showed us how to make were marvels, amazing and valuable toys that fit into your pocket. Walking the game trails barefoot, you could pull your whistle out and blow notes whenever you felt the desire. To this day, I can't make them work the way he did, or even at all. Somewhere along the years, I forgot some important notch with the knife, or the shape of the flat hollow area under the bark or something. Down the hill, below the cache Oliver helped my dad build, now nearly gone, a small clump of willows grows straight and true. We found them when Oliver sent us out to find the straightest willows around. After being flattened by breakups, they still come back perfect. Even tonight, those willows are out there, tall. I could run down with a flashlight and cut one right now. When the sap runs in the spring, occasionally I do wander down with a saw to cut a short section. I feel bad cutting one of those willows, straight as bamboo, knowing I won't succeed. I try to resurrect a perfect whistle, but it never comes out right. It never whistles. It won't make a sound. And I wait several more years before I try again. Thinking about that lets loose a string of memories. And tonight, in the dark, by flashlight, I hurry over to our old workbench and dig in the drawer. Under new screwdrivers with red plastic handles and gray hacksaw blades and files, sure enough, there amid sawdust and stray pencils are old handmade tools. A tear comes to my eye when I pull out a tiny antler-handled saw. My saw. How could I have forgotten my saw? Oliver helped me make it. I loved that little saw like a friend for so many years. I used it 1,000 times to cut caribou antlers and willows, spruce roots, and forked limbs for slingshot handles. Next, I pull out a crooked knife, and after more rummaging, I find an awl. Cole and I loved making awls with Oliver. They were so sharp and useful for drilling holes in moose hide and leather and wood. Finally, I find a tool I'd long forgotten, but somehow knew was in the drawer. A flat spruce handle, 1 foot long, and 1/2 inch by 1.5 inch, the folding saw Oliver made with us almost 50 years ago. When I lift it, out drop its 2 hand-filed blades and the stub of 1/3, snapped off at some point. Peened nails rivet the ends of the wooden handle tight. A bolt with 1 hand-filed nut acts as a pivot for the 2 cross-cut blades. In green and red marker are faint, faded words, Cole and Seth. Wind blows outside, and in the darkness a gust of raindrops pelts the roof. Under the small circle of light, I remember more. Oliver walking with me out on the tundra, behind my dad's cache. He's tall, with long legs in wool pants and worn leather boots. Peering at small trees, he's searching for the perfect spruce. It must be thin and narrow and a black spruce, whatever that means. I don't know that spruce can be black or white, only that Oliver is helping me make a bow. And of course, that means arrows, too, with tips and beautiful split duckwing feathers. And each arrow pierces another memory of that quiet, earnest, eminently resourceful man we all knew as Oliver, up and down this river, along the shores of my childhood. Plenty of Beaver. My daughter China and I are skimming past sweepers, boating up the Hunt River. Snow cliffs line the north bank, and ice sheets drape the rock bar along the other shore. We're heading up a tributary that flows out of the mountains to the north. Breakup swept through here just a few days ago, and now rafts of ice tower in contorted mounds. Pintails and widgeons paddle into the current and lift off, and a kingfisher swoops and dives ahead of us. After 7 months or more of ice, we're traveling on water. The sun shines off windy blue and white ice. Up on the bank, peering out of the alders, a cow moose on a snowdrift eyes us, wondering if harm comes along with the sound of this engine. She doesn't wish to run, having positioned herself in a curve in the river to give birth to a calf and defend it against the hungry brown bears. Two Canada geese lift off a sandy island point, doing the same thing as the moose, no doubt. Over the drone of my 20-horsepower outboard, sparrow songs pierce the air. Spring is here. We and all these creatures have made it through another winter, although some of these birds wisely went south for the duration. In the mud and willows along the shores at waterline, the golden glint of peeled saplings catches our eyes. Up higher, poplars lean off stumps, as if an army of woodchoppers has moved up this valley. Everywhere is the sign of beaver. In my lifetime, there have always been beaver. Plenty of lodges, plenty of dams. Now the population seems to be exploding. Something is different. A few years ago, I started noticing more beaver setting up homes along riverbanks. Some of my friends in the Eskimo villages, hunters, commented on the same thing. I remember beaver living in lakes, one family with one lodge and one or more dams, keeping the water at a level deep enough to not freeze out in midwinter. In late summer and into fall, the beaver families gathered food piles in front of their doors. Come spring, they kicked their teenagers out to face the daunting task of swimming out to the main river, surviving boat hunters, finding an unclaimed home site, meeting a girlfriend or boyfriend, and building a home and a new food pile, all before the next freeze-up, when the lakes and sloughs and river freeze over and become impassable. Most of that lifestyle hasn't changed. Lately, though, beaver are simply building along the banks of rivers, right out in the open, accessible to hunters, and sometimes even in sight of their beaver neighbors. Now a brown head crosses the current in front of our boat. Far downstream, one of his cousins whacks his tail on the water. We don't see the animal, just the plume in the distance, like a .30-06 bullet hitting water. Since I noticed this new beaver behavior, I've also noticed that late-season rains have raised the current in the rivers and washed away countless hard-stacked food piles, something that doesn't happen when a lake floods. And I've wondered, how does a family make it through the winter when the last thing to happen before winter is the loss of all its food? Somehow, though, many of them do. There are a lot of beaver, an amazing number of them. Normally, I'd say they are doing great, but today, here, alone in the beautiful wilderness with just my camera and dog and daughter and a sunny day stretching away forever, I think of overpopulated cities elsewhere on this same planet, of Myanmar and Sichuan province, and I wonder, are all these beaver really doing well, or are there just a lot more of them? Glassing for caribou. Along the river just before midnight, the north breeze falls away and the sun drops low enough in the north to spread golden light across the tundra. The smell of melting out soil and last autumn's leaves, cottonwood buds and pussy willow pollen, is almost honey sweet in the air. The night is calm and still, and at the same time ringing with song. A million avian tourists having just arrived. Sparrows and thrushes and warblers, all busy and excited and singing about it. Robins announce some shrill irritation. Terns and gulls cry and wheel over the river ice. Canada geese honk in the distance. And the invisible and relentless warbling wings of kukukak, snipes, remind everyone of their territories. I grab my binoculars, skirt the woodpile, and scramble up our old wooden tower. I'm looking for caribou. And everything else, too. I've been up here a dozen times today already to look out over the land and see what breakup is up to. I climb fast, even though some of the steps are loose, the spruce pieces rotten. It's lucky I'm light because the whole tower is gray, weathered, and rickety. My brother peeled the poles and built it more than 30 years ago. The steps peter out. Below, the world is a huge fling of white and blue river, tundra, mountains, and sky. Most of the treetops are under me now, and I grip the platform and clamber up onto the last section, the old steel tower from the Sioux City wind charger my parents bought in 1976. At the very top, I brace my binocs under the tail and swing it around to start from upriver, as far as I can see around the shoulder of this bluff, toward the land south of Onion Portage, to the low, distant blue mountains. Below me, the current carries ice pans down this side of the Kobuk, and the far side, too. The center ice is still a wide, white highway, stretching upriver as far as I can see to the island opposite Olwick's old igloo, then down to the west, past the Hunt River and Clarence Wood's lonely, wind-shredded cabin perched on the tundra bank. Widgeons and pintails paddle in the flooded willows, whistling and quacking, scooping up floating seeds. Across the river, spruce line the shore, glowing pale green the way they do this time of year in the night sun. Snowdrifts below the timber are bright white, and a cow moose stands there, munching willows from the platform of the packed drift, stopping occasionally to stare at ice pans gliding past. Incrementally, I swing south to glass the huge brown tundra stretching to the warring mountains. There, finally, are the scattered dots of caribou, marbles glowing in the evening light. It's great to see them. What took so long, guys? For months, the traveling has been firm and solid, lots of windblown tundra. Now the ice is breaking up, and the shoreline and sloughs are a maze of flooded willows and alders, the waterways treacherous crossings. And the cows are pregnant, just hours away from having their calves. It was an icy spring, with temperatures near zero into mid-May. Meltwater refroze, and wind and snow blotted out tundra that had already gone brown. I spent time up here on the tower, clinging on in the wind, peering at gray sky shrouding gray land. On my snow go, I was lucky to find caribou, a few weeks ago, back toward the Jade Mountains. We needed meat, though I had wanted the normal fare for this season, fresh goose. I haven't seen caribou since. I've been watching daily, lonely for them. I sweep my binocs down and bump into the huge dark lump at the top of a tall spruce directly across the river, a growth that my wife and daughter have named the Apakilik tree, for my Eskimo name. There along the riverbank, three swans take off directly toward me, wings thumping the water. They've got some marital issues to sort out, and they've been squabbling and beating their wings all afternoon. Farther south, something catches my eye behind a row of spruce beyond Horseshoe Lake. Finally, I get a better glimpse. Gray cranes flying low, and beneath the cranes, caribou fill the binoculars, a small herd grazing. On a ridge, a distant dark shape looks unfamiliar. I breathe and watch. It's miles away, but I hold still and wait. Finally, the shape elongates. The color shifts to black and then almost white. For a moment, it's clearly a grizzly bear, and just as quickly it turns, again a nondescript dot on the land. Along the base of the warrens, the Kobuk sand dunes form a long sandy line. Closer, on the tundra, a string of caribou stretches in this direction. I get excited and try to remember what lens I left on my camera. I slide my binocs down the snow along the riverbank, past a fake moose, a big black stump that's fooled me before. Above the willow island, a small group of caribou stands on an ice pan, surrounded by water, indecisive and awaiting leadership. Small gulls circle and perch beside them. Beyond the Hunt River, clumps of alders dot the tundra. Snowdrifts are white squiggles, almost too distant to distinguish. I imagine movement, and then there it is, a half dozen caribou moving toward the mountains. The duck pond is flooding, floating the ice, and through willow thickets I see the Nuna River running ice, flooding pans over the bank. A marsh hawk patrols a grassy swamp. Poor guy, I think. No mice this spring, not even in our sod igloo, where they always make camp. Last summer and fall were too rainy, too much flooding, tough for mice. Where two ponds meet, in the reeds and grasses, goosenecks are visible. I hear their distant hollering, fighting and mating, I guess. On the north side of the biggest lake, the ice runs to the snowdrift, and I see two black dots on the snow in front of a half-buried black lodge. Mr. Beaver has been out in the sun for the last few days, and I'm glad to see he's finally brought his wife out, too. Or maybe it's the other way around. I can't help wondering, as much as I love spring, maybe it's nothing compared to how a beaver feels when he pokes his head out into the air and sun after being stuck in the lodge all winter, in the dark and under ice. Maybe my exhilaration is little compared to how a moose feels after all the terror and hardships of winter, and the bears in their dens, and all these songbirds, sandpipers, and Arctic terns so happy to arrive from all the places they've been, the States, Antarctica, open ocean, and wherever else they've traveled. I don't want to climb down yet. I start again, glassing the whole world in the opposite direction. If my friend Alvin Williams were here, he'd stay up even longer than me, inhaling the land through his eyes. We grew up together, staring at this land, searching it, wandering across it in the bright nights, hunting and hunting and hunting, and we both know this addiction. There, already in the river, swimming this way, backs bleached white as ice, is a herd of caribou. The lead cow struggles in loose ice, trying to climb out on the main ice sheet. Behind her, the herd is like a rope beginning to swing sideways in the current. The pale knobs of warbles, a parasitic fly that burrows under the skin, shows in their hair, and the black of the bull's new velvet antlers is visible in the distance. I sprint down the tower, not stopping to glance below my boots or around the woodpile to see if a bear has wandered close, as they sometimes do while I was up in the air. I want to get my camera and tripod before the caribou splash into the willows and begin climbing this bluff. As I swing onto the ground, behind me there's a roar and shuddering of air. For an instant, a spruce grouse startles the heck out of me. It settles in a tree. Alert and alarmed, too. I smile at it, then glance around the brush quickly. I don't mind my heart beating faster. It's part of spring, and I run to meet the caribou. Cups of gold. There's been a brown bear at the sauna, and a male black bear, Dad, China tells me. I just smile. Don't judge her 8-year-old abilities. Get another armload of wood, I suggest. It's finally breakup. She's finally done Xing days off her calendar till school's out, and we're finally home, prying the boards off the door at Kapakavik. Ice pans still dot the river. The air temperature is 70, but inside the igloo it remains cold, insulated the way it's supposed to be, only 10 or 12 degrees above freezing. We warm up outside under singing birds, sunshine, and stray mosquitoes, then go back in and build a fire, sweep up mouse turds, and fill the kettles to make hot water. Want me to read you Huck Finn? China drags volume 1 of the Mark Twain collection over by the crackling barrel stove. She sits on a stump. I sit in my dad's old black rocking chair, salvaged from the Fairbanks flood of 1967, and crank the coffee grinder. She reads aloud about the widow Douglas and Tom and Pappy selling the new judge a line about going clean but By and by, in the night, developing a powerful thirst and slipping out for a jug of 40 rod. My mind is thinking coffee, and also that it doesn't sound like a whole lot has changed in the last 150 years. The water in the kettle heats. I keep jumping up to watch for caribou crossing. Outside, sunshine is everywhere, and down below, the big river rolls by. No boats are passing. The nearby town of Ambler is out of gas again, and when some does come in, it will be expensive. After coffee, there's lots to do, but no hurry. We have to boat up to the village in a couple days to meet the Hageland aviation plane and pick up my wife, Stacy, but right now we've forgotten clocks.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.